Shabbat shalom, everybody, and you're welcome to the Shabbat of this morning. The parasha that we are going to discuss about this morning is Parasha Ki-Tetzeh, which means when you go out. Parasha Ki-Tetzeh, when you go out. And this morning, I subtitle the parasha, The Captive Woman, Her Perspective. The subtitle of the parasha of this morning is The Captive Woman, Her Perspective. Because why did I give this subtitle? It's because we need to understand and know that the Torah is it is said that the Torah is written from the man perspective. So I want us to look at it also from the perspective of the woman, or the woman that is captured. Right, because as he said that the winner write history. It is always the winner that write history. So in this case now, I want us to look at it from the other perspective. So that is why I totally perspective of the captive woman, the captive woman perspective. This week's parasha begins on an anonymous note, which says, when you go out to war against your enemies. Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 10. The following five verses details what may be done with a woman of a beautiful apparent, which is Eshet Yefat-Toar. See, a woman of a beautiful apparent. If you that is captured by an Israeli soldier or by a Hebrew soldier. So what can be done to this type of a woman? Remember that the Torah gave us a law that we should not intermarry with those people of the land. But Moshe Rabbeinu, full of wisdom and understanding, understand one thing for the fact and for the truth. And the truth of the fact is that as a man, we are what? We are a visualized being. Right, we as a human being, both men and women, we are created to have this a mind that is what is visualized. And so when we see a woman, even though we've been commanded not to intermarry with them, but sometimes we cannot hold on to our what, to our hormone. When their testosterone goes high, then, or when our adrenaline go high, then we become to act like an animal. So in order for us not to do what? Not to step upon the mitzvah or the mitzvah that has been commanded us by Moshe, that is, Moshe created a way out. So in this sense, if a Hebrew soldier find a woman of a beautiful appearance, that is beautiful in nature, in figure, in everything, and he desire her to marry her, then that woman shall undergo some certain kinds of rituals. And we are going to understand, we are going to see what kinds of ritual the woman will undergo. The Torah viewed this situation from the male perspective and addresses its legislation to the captor. But what, I wonder, might have been the emotional experience of a captive woman as she underwent the transformation described in a passage from alien to an Israelite. I have attempted to create an imaginary narrative that encompasses the biblical text and its commentaries. Of course, the spectrum of possible narrations is limited only by the individual imagination of those who undertake such an exercise. I invite you all to release the captive within you or within yourself and see who emerges. I want you to please release your mind, have an open mind, and let us dodge into this situation or to examine what the Torah is talking about here. Because as I said, everything is from the man perspective. And God is, and I want us to understand from the other side, not only from the winner side. Let us see what the other people think. Because if we say that this is what we only think, that this is the fact, that might not be the old fact. So the other side might have their own fat also. So we have to consider their own fat. As the Torah gave us a commandment last week, that when you judge, we talk about shofting. When you judge, the judge shall look at case one and look at the right man and look at the case of the left man, and then can bring his own judgment. You should not only listen to one side of the story. You have to listen to the both side of the story, and from there you can make a righteous judgment. So therefore, I want us to imply that into this week a parasha. Because if we base only everything on the victor, then we are not doing justice. So let us also look at the side of the victim, or the side of those that has been defeated. So I want us to I create a kind of narratives, right, that I want us to indulge in this morning, to see how a captive woman or how a captive person feel after being captured in the war zone. She said, the captive woman now, "I can't believe that I am alive. The panic and the pillage were horrible. When yesterday the enemy overran our town, we had been warned how savagely the children of Abraham deal with the children of Lot, his kinsmen, who was also our forefathers. The soldiers made us lie down with our faces in the dust, roped together in three lines, men, women, and young ones like me. I could only hear the piteous cry of my people being slaughtered. My own father and mother and my fiancé, to whom I have not yet got married to. Then we who were left alive were made to parade past the enemy's warriors. I saw one cast his eye on me and grinned. He said something to one of the officers, and I was taken out of the line. Those of us choosing spend the night huddled together for warmth. She had since daybreak, we have been huddled behind the enemy's army, marching away from the king's highway, leaving behind our home, Rabat Moab, smothering in the distance. I pray to you, she prayed to our gods, protect me from these barbarians, for I know not where I go, nor what is to become of me." We can see how groaning this woman is groaning. She's groaning in pain for the experience that she has experienced, for what she has seen with her two naked eyes, how her father, her mother were being slaughtered like what? Like goats. How all the village is being overrun by the Israeli army. How they've been destroyed and consumed. So if we look at it from our own perspective, to her, the children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are what? Are barbaric. In our own mind, in our own set of mind, these are barbaric, evil, bad people. But is that so? Is that true? Because here we are going to see what God, or by the wisdom of Moshe, by God, that God has commanded Moshe that we should do to a captive people. Because we can understand and know that what is going on in the world that we live to today, even though in the 21st century, in the war zone, our women, children were being molested, right? Our women and children were being killed. Our women and children were being raped. Our women and children were being sold into slavery. Human trafficking is spread in a war zone. So we can understand that perfectly well. But from 5,000 years ago, Moshe is giving us this understanding that we cannot act like that. We, as the children of God, we can understand that God loves all his creation equally. The Holy One of Israel, blessed be he, loves all his creation equally. And God is giving us this example that we will not act like the barbaric life of those who have left before us. We have to work, improve our ways. We have to live like a human being, not like an animal. Because we understood and we realized and we know for sure how the Moab or how the Amalek or how the other Canaanite nation deal with their captive women or captive men. How they offer them unto their gods. How they rape women and how they destroy cities and burn them down. But the Lord our God doesn't want us to behave like that. He said, if you see a woman of a beautiful apparent, this is what you are going to do. This is how you are going to do what? You will not behave like those men, like those people who behave barbaric, who start raping women in the war front, in the war zone. You cannot do that. That is absolutely unacceptable and it is banned. If you see a woman that you like, you shall take her home and then she's going to stay for 1 month. She's going to mourn for her parents, for her mama and for her dad that died or that has been killed in the war. Then you are going to make her to look ugly. And if you still as a man love her in her ugliness, then you are going to love her when she's beautiful even more. She continued. She said, we travel for days and days, huddled together, following the army. I am numb with exhaustion and fear. When we crossed the Jordan, I was separated from my companions. I have lost everything I loved. I feel so empty. All alone among these alien people, she cried out. She yearned and she groaned. I am washed and cared for by a bunch of old women who are constantly babbling to each other in a language I can somehow understand. Remember, the language is very similar. Today, they came into the tent I am kept in and made me strip off my dress. How bitter it was for me to hear them call this last remnant of my home a garment of captivities. At first, I was sure they were finally preparing me to be raped by the man who seems to have singled me out for his own. But then they made me shave my hair and my fingernail grow long. How could anyone think I look more attractive this way? What strange people I have been captured by. I weep constantly for my mom and for my dad. Their cries are still in my ears. She continued groaning in her pain. Weeks have passed since I was taken from home. The numbness and emptiness I feel seem only to deepen. All that came before is beginning to fade, like another lifetime lived in someone's ass. Or like another lifetime lived by someone else. The old women realize I understand their language and have been telling me old stories. They say that generation ago, there was a Moabite woman like me named Ruth, who came to live among them and became the ancestor of their king, David. They say I must not pray to Chemosh, which is their gods. That is the chief god of the Moab. But like Ruth accepted the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, whose image I have not yet seen or whose name I have not heard. They tell me I may become like their matriarchs, Rahel, Leah, and Tamar, the wives of men descended from Abraham, their patriarchs, who was the ancestor of our patriarch, Moab. I cannot deny who I was, yet I cannot escape what is happening to me, and I cannot hold out against whatever is to be in the future. Soon, the full moon will emerge again, as it did on the night after I was captured. I have not seen again the man who brought me here. Moabite men will certainly not treat a captive woman This way, that is her own imagination. That is what she's thinking in her head. Because she actually doesn't know what their men do when they capture women. The old women have told me that tonight it is finally permitted to come in and lie with me. And after that I will be not his slave, but his wife. And I will then be considered one of them. I can see them outside making preparation for the wedding feast. And I can hear them beginning to sing their song, which seems to beckon me to sing with them. And the song goes, "Sing, O barren one, you who have not beard. Cry aloud, you who have not travailed with child. Enlarge the place of your tent, and stretch forth the curtains of your habitation. For your seed shall possess nations. Fear not, for you shall not be ashamed. You shall forget the humiliation of your youth. For he who possesses you is your maker. The Lord of hosts is his name, and your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. The God of the whole earth he is called." What can we take from this brief discussion? I want us to understand, what can we take from this brief discussion I just discussed now? Let's see in the book of 2 Samuel chapter 8 verse 2. 2 Samuel chapter 8 verse 2 tells us that when David conquered Moab, he made the captive lie down on the ground in three lines. That is, Havalim, two of which were put to death and one of which he kept alive. This despite the fact that according to Genesis chapter 19 verse 36 to 37, Moab, the progenitor of the Moabites, was the first son of Lot, the nephew of Abraham. The national god of the Moabites was Chemosh, which is said in number 21 verse 29, who seems to have presented a threat to the Israelite faith in the book of 1 Kings chapter 11 verse 7. Deuteronomy chapter 21 verse 12 prescribed a detail. What must be done with a woman taken in war? That we the Israelites, that we the Hebrew people, will not behave barbaric like other people, what that has been before us, or that we shall not behave barbaric like those people who were about to be displaced from the land. The Sefer, section 212, to this verse record a difference of interpretation between early sages. Rabbi Eliezer argued that doing her nail, that is, Vahasta el zippor neha, means that she should pare them down, just as she was to shave the hair of her head. But Rabbi Akiva argued that since shaving her hair was form of disfigurement, her nails should be allowed to grow unattended, since this was even more disfiguring. It seems that shaving the head and perhaps the other practices as well were intended to make the female captive as unattractive as possible and prevent her being exploited sexually during the month allowed to her to mourn, having been forcefully taken away from her parental home and native people. So this form is a form of, I would say, the kind of rahamin. It's a form of mercy that God is saying that we will not behave like a barbaric people, like those people that were going to do what? We are going to dispel out of the land. So all the law, all the mitzvot that was given us in this parasha is all about the law of rahamin. Even though when we consider the law of the of the bird, that we shall drive away the mother bird and take only the what? The egg. All this that God has commanded us, and also when we see our brothers' animals being lost, or when we see things that is being lost, that we shall return it back. So all the law, the mitzvah that is given in this parasha, looking at it perfectly well, is all about what? It's all about the law of Rahamim in short form. So God is asking us to be what? To be merciful. To be like our Creator. As our Creator is merciful and is just, God wants us to be merciful, to be compassionate and just as the same. So that when we go to war, we cannot behave like a barbaric people. We cannot behave like an animals, but we have to behave like a human beings. Even though we've been commanded to do what? To destroy them, that we still have to do that humanly. Not because we are righteous. No, the Torah says it's not because of our righteousness. It's just because God loves us. That is why God is giving us this land. Because these people, they refuse to do what? To do what is right and just. So here, our rabbis is telling us this, that all these things that Moshe gave us, all this commandment, is to make the woman not to be exploited sexually, not to be raped, that the woman can still be a woman, even though during wartime, that a human being can still behave like a human being, not like an animal, even though during wartime. The ancient exegesis, if we look at Sefer Deuteronomy section 213 of the Babylonian Talmud, the Kiddushin 21b, and a traditional Yehudim commentator, and modern ones as well, understood the legislation recorded in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 10 to 14, as designed primarily to prevent the rape of women captured in war. Some commentators suggest that the rituals specified in our passage were intended to facilitate the transition of such woman from the status of a foreigner and their assimilation into Israel as the wife of an Israelite man, which is also true, that no matter what, we have to still keep our humane, that no matter what, even in war, that we still have to keep that ourselves, our mind, that we should not lose our mind, that we should still be compassionate and be merciful. So, when Boaz married Ruth, the Moabite, the people expressed the hope and expectation that the woman he is wedding be like Rahel, Leah, and Tamar. Through the offspring, she will bring into this house. Their son, Oev, was the father of Yishev, who was the father of David. You can also read that, finish that reading in the book of Ruth. You can see that in the book of Ruth. So my main concern and the main message that I'm trying to tell us this morning is about the other view, other side. What does a woman that is captured in war, what do they feel? How is their experience? Because we can say, yes, we conquered them, we win them, and we are now what? We are now the victors. But what about those people that we capture? How is their feeling? What is their side of the story? So, and that is why I brought up this discussion concerning the parasha of this morning, to look at it from the view or from the perspective of the woman that is captured in war. What is her view? How does it feel? Or how does she feel? How is her feeling to the captor? Is she going to be sincere and loyal? Or is he going to say, no, I'm going to do what? Deal with them, and I'm going to do what? Do something negative against my husband. Or is she going to be loyal to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and live accordingly to our tradition and to our faith? So this is a food for thought for each and every one of us this morning, that yes, we are victorious. Yes, we have everything, but can we look at the other side? Can we look at how they feel, and can we look at what is happening to the other side? Parasha Ki-Tetzeh, the captive woman, our perspective, the perspective of the captive woman. Shabbat Shalom.
There's a river.